We are this evening connecting a complex and distressed region here in the Middle East, captured in roiling conflict and endemic corruption, where doing the right thing, or what may seem as such, can all too quickly lead to the wrong outcome. A special kind of hell, that tragic assessment direct from the UN Secretary General, describing what it is like to be a child in Yemen. In fact, the United Nations says for just about anyone living in Yemen now, life is unbearable. A newly released report says years of brutal conflict have left two-thirds of the country's population in desperate need of help. One official warning, Yemen could slide into a famine unlike any the world has seen for decades. So today, the United Nations is launching a global effort to raise almost $4 billion for Yemen. It is holding a virtual donor conference, the second in 9 months, with more than 100 governments and others taking part. Here is the Secretary General, Antonio Guterres.
It is impossible to overstate the severity of the suffering in Yemen. More than 20 million Yemenis need humanitarian assistance and protection, with women and children among the hardest hit. That means two out of every three people in Yemen need food aid, health care, or other life-saving support from humanitarian organizations.
Already, the United Arab Emirates, where I am broadcasting from, has pledged $230 million, a good start, but just a fraction of what is needed from governments around the world. This conference coming on the heels of an attack in Yemen Sunday that killed five people, including a child. The Saudi-backed coalition and Houthi rebels each blaming the other for that attack. This is such an important story, and one that we all really, really need to take note of. Achim Steiner, the United Nations Development Programme Administrator, joining me now via Skype from New York. And it is good to have you with us. An adequately funded aid operation will prevent the spread of famine and create the conditions for lasting peace. If you are not feeding the people, you are feeding the war, says Mark Lowcock, the UN Emergency Relief Coordinator. He went on to say, we are at a crossroads with Yemen. We can choose a path to peace or let Yemenis slide into the worst famine for decades. How, sir, would $4 billion be spent and by whom to avert what the UN aid chief has said would be a large-scale man-made famine?
Thank you, Becky. And as Mark Lowcock and the Secretary General have said, we face an unprecedented crisis, and it is one that the international community, over 6 years of war, has been trying to at least mitigate with humanitarian aid and also development interventions. Because the two things that define the ability of people to survive right now is, first of all, access to food, and secondly, income. And these are the two major thrusts that are clearly at the center of these appeals. And right now, humanitarian aid means also basic healthcare support. We have to imagine a country that after 6 years of war has essentially lost its healthcare infrastructure, a significant part of its education infrastructure. The economy is really on its knees, and even the importation of food through the ports is severely hampered because of the destruction of infrastructure, making it even more expensive. These are the areas into which the humanitarian appeal tries to immediately provide support. And as you have heard, this is literally a matter of life and death for hundreds of thousands of people, and in terms of chronic food shortages for millions of people. That is why this appeal is so dramatic, so urgent. And a reminder that in 2020, we only managed to mobilize less than half of what was needed. So the country is chronically and acutely in crisis.
How confident are you that you will get anywhere close to the target of $3.75 billion?
Well, in a world that is currently distressed, where aid budgets, humanitarian budgets are obviously being stretched, it is always difficult to predict. But I think the understanding of the dramatic nature of the crisis, the urgency, Sweden, Switzerland, and the United Nations coming together to host the international community, I think augurs well, and certainly the prospects of peace, also with the work of the special envoy of the Secretary General, Martin Griffiths, progressing the changed U.S. position in terms of the dynamics in the region. All this also holds promise that there may finally be an end to this war, and that is the precondition also for recovery and for development. So I think the international community both cannot turn away from the human desperation right now, but perhaps also with a greater sense of hope and possibility, will come back to where it was in 2019, which was a funding level more equivalent to what is being called for right now.
What happened, of course, in late 2019 was that countries became very concerned about how any money might be spent and by whom, it has to be said. How do you reassure countries that any money pledged won't get funneled to the very actors on the ground causing this cruelty? And I am specifically talking here about the Houthis who run Sana'a and much of the north, scene of the worst suffering, sir.
Well, first of all, the humanitarian agencies, whether in the United Nations system, the World Food Programme, UNICEF and others, we clearly have, and UNDP on the country as well, because we actually work in most of the governorates of the country right now in order to provide the fiduciary supervision and integrity to ensuring that these funds actually reach those who are in need. And together with the international NGOs also, that is a key task. And I think while there might be instances where food sometimes gets stolen, the chain of custody and the supervision and the monitoring certainly are part of the backbone of the international community's commitment to helping bring those funds to the people that need it. But let us also be clear, we operate in a war zone, and sometimes you have not got absolute control over it. But this is what our commitment as the United Nations system is, to ensure insofar as we can maintain control and the chain of custody, that this support does reach people. And if you look at the record in recent years, whether in Yemen or in other countries, then with exceptions and sometimes beyond the control of anyone, this is largely what has happened. And so I think there should be no reason to withhold any support right now because of that potential risk, which is minor because of the many measures that have been put in place and the way that our agencies work on the ground with staff who are actually posted in the country and are risking their lives to ensure that the international community can deliver its aid.
Staff who are overstretched and underfunded. Sir, thank you. That is the story on the ground, and that is the narrative about why the world needs to pony up on Yemen. Thank you for joining us.